two that, that Mr. Ewing had denied to the officer any affiliation with the Hustle Boys gang. Further, Mr. Ewing says that there was a key omission in that affidavit, specifically that Mr. Ewing was misidentified by Raymond Love in the photo array. With respect to that omission, the ruling, as previously stated, in regards to the Raymond Love photo array identification, the court does not view this as an omission and thus not material or relevant to this analysis. Regarding the two alleged false statements, the law with respect to whether or not an individual is entitled to a Franks hearing or an evidentiary hearing is that if there's a substantial preliminary showing that number one, false statement was knowingly and intentionally made in that affidavit, and number two, the false statement is necessary to finding a probable cause. As far as the court's concerned, the affidavit included the statement that Raymond Love, an eyewitness, identified Mr. Ewing as the shooter in this homicide. And frankly, that's more than enough probable cause to, with respect to that data, to search Mr. Ewing's Facebook for further evidence of crimes or crimes related to the incident on his head. The alleged false statement regarding the Hustle Boys may or may not be correct in terms of Mr. Officer Lund putting that in the affidavit. As I've already stated, it frankly doesn't really matter. Probable cause was found as soon as the statement that there's been an identification of this individual in homicide and shooting. So probable cause had already been shown to search the Facebook account of the suspect. The Hustle Boys statement, false or otherwise, is irrelevant in this analysis as prong two to allow the individual to get an evidentiary hearing is that the false statement is necessary to find the probable cause. The court finds the information related to the Hustle Boys was not necessary to provide the probable cause, and even if excised from that affidavit, probable cause still exists for that magistrate to sign. The court finds the reasonable person would conclude the same. And the court's ruling is that there is not a substantial showing that a false statement was made, and if it was made, that last of what I've called the substantive rulings is going to be the next ruling. This is in regards to Mr. Ewing's motion to dismiss pursuant to Michigan Code 2.504B1. And specifically, this motion states that it should be dismissed, application dismissed with failure to hold the district court agreement on the basis of jurisdiction. So, let me backtrack. The motion for the Franks hearing is denied. The next motion that's going to move on is with respect to the motion to dismiss under MCR 2.504, is not regarding the arraignment. That is regarding the argument that the people had failed to respond pursuant to the court's order to our filing witness. That's the one I'm addressing this time. So, off the top, the court does not find that the prosecutors violated this rule. The rule states, the civil procedure rule, that if a party fails to comply with these rules or court order upon motion by an opposing party, or to respond to the court may enter a default against the non-compliant party or dismissal of the non-compliant party's action or claim. So, to give some context here, I would say common criminal proceeding, that might be one or two, three of the most filings that would require or potentially require a response. In this matter, Mr. Ewing, on the day of actually our first hearing in this court in June, when we set our trial date, he had already filed 16 motions, and deadline dates were set for August, and the day prior to that deadline date, another 20 motions were filed by Mr. Ewing. That's 36 total, not counting the dozens more supplemental briefs, reply briefs, and other such motions. Frankly, as is this court's practice, what I'm interested in is justice for both sides. And your laughter is noted for the record, Mr. Ewing. And in order to make an informed decision, oftentimes it's necessary to hear from both sides while also doing its own due diligence as a court to make the right decision. So to the extent people didn't reply or respond to some of Mr. Ewing's motions, the court doesn't find that it's in any way violating MCR 2.504B. And in particular, and as everyone knows, when we were here in June, the court set a motion due date, which is a hard due date, and set a response date. The court did not order responses to every motion. The court ordered if there would be a response, the court wants it by such and such a date. Prosecutor's office responded to almost all of the motions, and did not respond to others. I don't know if that was an oversight or if that was just a decision by the prosecutor's office that they thought they didn't need to respond. What I simply did was order a response to the, I did not respond, not order a response to each and every motion. The court found that in a couple particular cases, the court didn't receive a response from the people that the court found would be necessary in order to make a fully informed decision. Then I did order, as I did one or two motions that are hearing in October, that the people do respond before making the final determination. Prosecutor's office filed that order and responded to both of those motions. For those reasons, the court is going to deny this motion. The court does not find there's any sort of willful non-compliance by the prosecutor or prosecutor's office. Furthermore, doesn't find that there's any prejudice to this ruling with respect to any non-response to those filings. Next, this is the final substantive motion that the court will rule on. And this is in regards to Mr. Ewing's motion to dismiss for failure to hold a district court arraignment and jurisdictional defect due process violation. So, back when we were here in October, June, the court, because this motion was one of the motions that were filed in June when this case began, that Mr. Ewing has requested the bringing on the warrant transcripts from the district court, and that the court is going to request those transcripts, provide a copy to the parties. The court filed it to the clerk's office on September 28th. The clerk's office responded that the bringing on the warrant is not usually transcribed, but would check and hard file. Which is kept off-site, and subsequently confirmed to the court that the transcript of the agreement on the warrant was not included in the court file. So the court looked at some other avenues to make a determination regarding this motion. First, by way of reference, the court looked at the Register of Actions, which is a document that documents each and every court hearing from start to finish, pre-trial and post-trial in regards to any particular case. Pursuant to the Register of Actions, in this case, the arraignment on the warrant was held on January 12th of 2010 in front of Judge Sidney Barkwell. It's stated that Mr. Ewing, represented by Mr. Cripps at the time, stood mute to the charges and pled entered a plea not guilty to all charges. Court understands that sometimes the Register of Action isn't always 100% accurate, so we did some more digging, and lo and behold, we turned up in the original court file a couple documents from back in 2010. First document the court found was the recall of the warrant document. So this is a document that when an arraignment of a warrant is conducted at the district court, the warrant that was outstanding is recalled. The individual is arraigned, guilty, and then a bond is given. So if you look, you can see this is a pretty old document from 2010. It states with this case number and with respect to Mr. Ewing, who was represented by Mr. Chris at the time, who signed this document. Then on January 12th of 2010 is when the warrant was recalled and the bond was given a remand. The next court date was provided of January 14th, 2010. And this is all strong evidence that the arraignment on the warrant was in fact conducted, despite Mr. Ewing stating it wasn't the arraignment. This shows, number one, on the date that the Register of Action says the arraignment on the warrant took place, we have document that the warrant was recalled. That's only recalled in the circumstance where someone is arraigned on that warrant. Furthermore, it gives a bond, which is what would have been what would have happened, and which is the first time a bond is given in the matter. This was a first-degree murder charge, so, which almost always the bond is remanded, which says right here the amount of bond is remanded. Furthermore, this is signed by, as I stated, the Defense Counsel at the time, Mr. Cripps, and the next court date given, January 14, 2010, corresponds exactly with the Register of Actions, which states the next hearing was on January 14, 2010. Furthermore, the court discovered other documentation showing that this arraignment did in fact take place. Specifically, the bindover documentation from the court file, the district court, from this hearing, which states that the date of arraignment was January 12th, 2010, that the examination was held on February 4th, defense attorney Mr. Cripps, that was bound over on February 11th, bond remained the same at remand, and this is signed by the judge, the examining judge at the time, Judge Brent Peaks. This is just more evidence and information to show that Mr. Ewing was in fact arraigned on that warrant back in 2010. So, for those reasons, the court's going to deny that motion. All right, we're going to pivot a little bit here to the motions in limine that have been filed. One filed by the people and numerous filed by the start with an easy one. It's the only one that was agreed to or previously stipulated by both parties. And this is Mr. Ewing's motion to exclude irrelevant, unfairly prejudicial photos of assault weapons. In the people's response, there was no objection to exclusion of these photographs at trial. With respect to my second motion, the court is going to rule on this is sort of a cross reference one. This relates to the people filing a motion in limine to admit certain witness testimony given at trial, specifically of the testimony of Ms. Jindaya Love. Mr. Ewing, separate and apart, filed his own motion to exclude the reading of Jindaya Love's testimony under MRE 804B1 and the Confrontation Clause. This ruling will be with respect to both of these filings. So, background again, the testimony at issue is this dialogue who was apparently an eyewitness to the shooting, who testified back at the first trial in October, November of 2010, subsequently passed away in April of 2017. So the people, in essence, have made the motion to read in her trial testimony from 2010 into the record that the 2023-24 issue rules of evidence, particularly Rule 804 and 805, I'm sorry, 804A and 804B. So the meaning of the rule states that in 804A, one of the definitions of being unavailable as a witness, it includes a situation in which the declarant, who in this instance would be Ms. Love, is unable to be present or to testify at the hearing because of death. I think we can all agree that Ms. Love did in fact pass away, apparently based on the documentation, back in April 6th, 2017, and that the definition of unavailability as a witness would be met in standard. Moving on to subsection B, which states that the following are not excluded by the hearsay rule if the declarant is unavailable as a witness. Subsection 1 is the subsection at issue in this case. Testimony given as a witness